Good morning to everybody. Tere hommikust kõigile. It's a little bit strange for me to speak in English in Tallinn, but let's try. I'm going to talk about paraphilias or perversions, as they were called before, and I still do like the traditional word perversion, because I have myself a traditional psychoanalytic training, and it is very familiar in psychoanalytic texts to use the word perversion. But during the times it has become more and more kind of a negative word. So Wilhelm Steckel in the 1920s, who was a pupil of Freud, proposed a word paraphilia that is used nowadays. It is a synonym, and nowadays it is used widely. But we are talking about the same thing. I'm going to show you a lot of slides, but I'm going to skip off much material. So if you have questions, you can email me and ask for more. I come myself from a prison, been there for 12 years. The life sentence in Finland is usually 13 or 14 years, so it's already a kind of a life sentence in a prison. And we have a small hospital there. We have only 14 beds. There are 40 beds in other prison in Turku. And this is quite unusual in Nordic countries to have inside the prison system a psychiatric hospital. In other Nordic countries, usually prisoners are taken outside the prison in civilian hospitals, and they are treated there if they need psychiatric treatment. So we have quite a unique system, and we are quite satisfied with it, because it really works well. Prison psychiatry is a strange and very small part of forensic psychiatry. We have only 7 prison psychiatrists in Finland at the present moment, and well, the forensic psychiatrists, I think we have about 40. And so we travel a lot. Last summer we were in Scotland. That is also an interesting country, the same size like Finland, but they have 8 prisons in Scotland. In Finland we have 26 prisons, and this is absolutely too much. So in Estonia the situation is much better, because there are 3 large prisons, and if we try to organize medical services, psychotherapy, and let's also talk about the treatment of sex offenders, it's much more easier if you have only 3 prisons. In Edinburgh, they told us that the last trend in their prison is that they have more and more sex offenders. And at the present moment, there are about 800 beds in Edinburgh prison. They have about 200 sex offenders. And that is a lot. We asked about the explanation. What is the explanation? Why do we have so much sex offenders nowadays? And nobody knows. Maybe we do recognize better the sexual crimes. We really do find them better. That is a part of the explanation, at least. We can sentence them, put them to prison, but of course the Scottish system also takes quite a serious viewpoint on sexual crime, and they have much longer sentences than in Finland. The old Edinburgh prison was in Edinburgh Castle, and it looked like that 200 years ago. Something was better these days. Prisoners were offered 2 pints of beer every day. Not anymore. The Americans got a little bit less bread, because they were considered as pirates. So, I'm talking about a complexity of human sexual behavior, and I'm going to talk about dimensions. Human sexual drive, libido if you like, is also a dimension. Gender identity is also a dimension. And actually, if we are thinking about many psychiatric disorders, diseases, syndromes, then most of them are dimensions. Depression is a dimension, psychosis can be a dimension. Also, sexual disorders are dimensions. And some people have more sexual drive than the other people. There are also people that have very few sexual interests. They can be called asexuals. People who have worked with transsexuals, for example, know that it is not only men and women, but it is also a dimension. Some are very much males, and some are real females, and then there is something in between. The human sexual development, the development of the body, is also a long process. Tanner has proposed a five-stage scale when we think about the development of genitalia. And the first and the second stage, we can, if somebody is interested in boys or girls in the first or second stage, then we can talk about pedophilia. When somebody is interested in teenagers, then we have another word for it. We have hebephilia. When DSM-5 was created, they had discussions about changing the whole concept of pedophilia into pedohebephilia, but they did not take it. We still do have pedophilia. But of course, we do have offenders who are more interested in teenagers than in children. And children, I mean under 13. Then there are perverts. Well, maybe not perverts. They are actually normal people that are interested in adults. And these strange people are called having teleophilia. The concept, what is normal in sexual behavior, has changed a lot in the past decades. And, well, sometimes we think even maybe it's kind of a normal nowadays to be a little bit queer, have some kinky sex. It's not strange for us anymore that somebody is interested in strange sexual behaviors. But other behaviors are harmless, and some of them can be quite harmful. This is an Estonian politician just a couple of weeks ago who said that he thinks that homosexuality is a disorder because this is not normal. Scientists do not like to use these counterparts anymore, speaking about normal or abnormal phenomena. We better use the words usual and unusual. Well, to this politician, maybe we can tell that homosexuality as a disorder was taken away from the classification of diseases in 1980. So, although he is a young man, he lives in the past. This is a very old idea actually, the disposition to perversions or paraphilias is an original and universal disposition of a human sexual instinct. A normal sexual behavior is developed out of it. The cultures have different views on unusual sexual behavior, and some of them are more conservative and some of them are more liberal. We have cultures that are very suppressive, and then we have cultures that are ambivalent, and actually we do not have much states or cultures where we have permissive or supportive viewpoints on sexuality. And sexual behavior and sexual disorders are not only medical concepts. There is a profound influence of social, cultural, religious, political, and legal views on how we treat these sexual disorder or unusual sexual behavior. I remember myself in 1970s, this was a very important book written by Finnish authors, and there were, it was really terrible these times, some pages about sex. No information these days. We do not. I don't remember any education about sexual behavior these days, or any much knowledge about homosexuality, for example. My 81-year-old mother told me just a couple of days ago that she looked. She saw a television program, and there was a young man, and a very successful young man, and he had a beautiful house, and he had a company, and everything was really nice until it was revealed that he was a homosexual, having a relationship with a man, and having adopted a child. And my mother was terrified. It's really, really, really weird. But times change, and our attitudes towards sexual behavior also do change. We are talking about very serious matters when we are talking about pedophilia, for example. And that is an example I think was in the newspapers about a couple of weeks ago. And that tells us, I think, pretty well about how serious matters we are talking about. Schengenholt has a concept of soul murder. That means that some experiences could be so traumatic that a human being can never survive from them. And in Holland, there was a young woman who applied for euthanasia because she had been sexually abused for a long time and she had very serious symptoms after that. And now he's dead. That has risen, of course, a lot of discussion about euthanasia in psychiatric problems. Okay, about these dimensions, something more about these dimensions. There are several interesting studies about sexual fantasies, and you must remember, fantasies and thoughts are very different things than behavior. We can think about, fantasize about all kinds of things, but this is not illegal. And even paraphilic sexual, even pedophilic sexual fantasies are surprisingly common. This is quite a recent study where it came out that about 57% of the sample met the criteria of paraphilia when sexual fantasies were concerned. Overall, I have some slides in Estonian, I'm sorry. I thought that maybe it could be a little bit more difficult for you, some of them in English and some of them in Estonian. It's quite difficult to study sexual disorders, and there are not very many well-done studies also. Study materials are quite small, the populations are small, they have methodological problems, we have all kinds of difficulties to arrange these studies and so on. So we still lack more adequate information about sexual disorders. It is also quite well known that a large part of sexual offences are never discovered or revealed, are never sentenced. We do not even know how large this part is. Maybe it is five times more sexual crimes, maybe even more than five times. We cannot ever get to court. So, about the dimensions. Paraphilic disorders are a spectrum from nearly normal behavior to the other end where they are hurtful or destructive towards others or oneself. Paraphilic disorders per se are not illegal, but acting in response to paraphilic urges may be illegal. This is also very important to remember that only about a half of all individuals who do sexually abuse children are pedophilic. This is a very interesting thing, isn't it? Maybe we easily think that if you do abuse a child, you are a pedophile. But not necessarily. So only a part of sexual offenders can be diagnosed with a paraphilia. And only a part of persons with paraphilia commit sexual offenses. There are different ways to classify paraphilias. We can talk about exclusive paraphilias, that means somebody is exclusively interested in children. But a person can also be interested in adults at the same time. I have at the present moment in our ward two patients. Another one is a fixated pedophile, has always been a pedophile from his youth, and another one is a man. At the present time, 72 years old, and he has engaged in pedophilic activities in his late years. We have heterosexual pedophiles, we have homosexual pedophiles, we have pedophiles who are interested in boys, we have pedophiles who are interested in girls, we have pedophiles who are interested in both sexes, we have incest, of course, and so on and so forth. The other way to classify paraphilias are two distinct acts, when we have hands-on behavior and when we have hands-off behavior. It's always worse when we already do touch somebody, or I mean a pervert. There are about 550 known paraphilias. That is a lot. But only some of them are important when legal or forensic psychiatric practices are concerned, and when pedophilia, of course, is one of them. I have also a very interested patient, a voyeurist, Peeping Tom. Maybe if we have time, I'll talk a little bit about him. But this is just an example of a list of all kind of queer sexual behavior. We do know somebody could be interested in dogs, and somebody in cats, or somebody in pain, or somebody in trees, or somebody in old women. I remember I thought I was really smart. These times I gave a patient of mine a diagnosis of gerontophilia. He was interested in elder women. He was abused by his grandmother. But there are lots and lots of... this is not from the last evening meeting, I think, because we did not have fish, we had something else. But there are lots and lots of them, over 500 of different paraphilias. Rape is not a paraphilia, and there is no diagnosis also for raping. And rape is considered to be more of a violent act, a violent crime, than a sexual crime. There also is some ideological pressure to think things these ways, because maybe it's not entirely so. But it is not a paraphilia. Most of the paraphilia patients are men. More than 90% of paraphilia patients are men. There is one exception, and this is sexual masochism. That is more typical for women. This is a very important idea also, that there is no typical profile of a sexual offender. They are very different people. There is not a typical pedophile. About a half of paraphilia patients have been abused in their young years themselves. This is also quite typical, that the motivation for treatment is not very good, and there are lots and lots of comorbidity. So it is quite typical that there are several paraphilias at the same time. There are other psychiatric disorders like anxiety disorders, depression, alcoholism is quite typical, and impulse control disorders. I remember having several pedophilic patients that had gambling disorders. So, sexual behavior is complex and a very, very difficult phenomenon. We do not know how to explain the paraphilias. What is the etiology? What is the reason why somebody turns out to be a pedophile? It seems to be a multifactorial disorder. There might be genetical disorders. There might be some risk factors affecting the children from their environment. But at the present moment, we do not have a good theory about pedophilia, what it is caused with. There was an interesting twin study in Finland some years ago that proposed that genetic factors are important. But if we consider schizophrenia, for example, in schizophrenia we think it is about 70 or 80% genetically predisposed condition. In pedophilia, it's about 15%. So it has some genetic background, but it does not explain much. If you have time, I can recommend you reading Joyce McDougall's old but brilliant book, The Many Faces of Eros. And she had her own word for paraphilia or perversion, as she was speaking about neo-sexuality. And about when the parental interjects are good enough, the individual may find neurotic rather than addictive and deviant solutions to sexual conflicts. Joyce McDougall has treated people with sexual disorders for several years, and it's really, really a brilliant book, but hard work to treat in long-term psychotherapy. I think this is not very clear, but this is a slide that tries to put together the information we have at the present moment about risk factors for pedophilia. And there seems to be some influence of hormonal levels during the fetal period, and we know about the second and the fourth finger. You can look at your second and your fourth finger, and we know something about dopamine, something about serotonin. We know some risk factors in early childhood. We know something about the deviant brain in pedophilia, about prefrontal cortex, about the orbitofrontal cortex, about amygdala, and so on. But we do not have, at the present moment, enough pieces yet to put together a theory. What causes pedophilia and what are the mechanisms? There was also another study that tells us that pedophilic fantasies are quite common, where it came out that about 20% of male students have pedophilic fantasies. And I again emphasize, this is not illegal or criminal to have pedophilic fantasies. It is also a very interesting question, what is the prevalence of pedophilia? How many pedophiles do we have around here? And the answer is, well, we do not know exactly. It seems that at least 1% of the population could fulfill the criteria of pedophilia. Some studies say maybe up to 3%. And if we think about, again, about schizophrenia, for example, we have more pedophiles around here than schizophrenia patients. It's always a human tragedy to have a pedophilic disorder, because it seems to be chronic. And it affects the normal life in very different ways. There are pedophiles that do never commit a crime, and they suffer from their condition and the present moment. At the present moment, you do not have any services to offer them. Where is the polyclinic where you can go if you are worried about your paraphilic, or let's say pedophilic, thoughts? No place to go. When we do assess our patients, we have a nurse. She has been trained in sexology, and she knows how to assess the patient and then can gather the sexual anamnesis that takes a long time. This is very thorough. You go through all the development stages and behavior and experiences one has, but it helps us a lot, but it takes time. What about the classification of diseases we have at the present moment? I'm not talking about sexual dysfunction or gender identity disorders today. Just paraphilic disorders are the topic. And there have been some changes in DSM-5. The interesting change was that we are talking nowadays about paraphilia and paraphilic disorders. So we try to make a difference between a condition that is already clearly harmful and causes distress. There were also thoughts about these paraphilic disorders, but as I already said, we still do have pedophilia at the moment. Some words about recidivism. It's easily understood that when somebody is a pedophile, then he is dangerous and tries to find new victims and make new crimes. But it is not so. The recidivism of sexual offenders is actually surprisingly low. Again, we do not know the exact number. There are different studies. There are numbers about 15 or 20%. Well, this is a classical study. 14% recidivism during the 5 years and 20% recidivism during the following 10 years. But that also tells us that most of the sexual offenders do not get a new sentence of a sex offense. So it seems that recidivism rarely exceeds 15%. We have also Finnish data, and in Finland it seems to be 11%. The Finnish registers are really good. And we have also some data about this group treatment, sex offender treatment program, or STOP program, as it is called in Finland, and it seems to be about 6.5%. That means that there are some offenders who do have a new sentence after this stop treatment, but this is quite rare. And it seems that this stop treatment decreases the risk for recidivism. It is also an interesting thought that sexual offenders are more likely to reoffend with a non-sexual offense than a sexual offense. There are several tools to assess the risk. This is just one of them by David Thornton, and static has been used also in Finland. This is an actuarial risk assessment scale. There are maybe a little more modern risk assessment scales nowadays that are called structural professional judgment, and they also take into account the dynamic factors, because if we have an actuarial scale, the risk is always the same. It does not change. It does not take into account the dynamic factors. It does not take into account the change. It does not take into account the protective factors. And this is just one type of a tool. This is a very interesting meta-analysis by Sina Faisal. She's a professor of forensic psychiatry in Oxford, and she has published several articles, some meta-analyses about risk assessment methods. And what are the results of our risk assessments, our professional risk assessments, using the best risk assessment tools we have at the present time? And it seems that the results are not so good at all. We would like to. Actually, our predictive abilities are the worst when we are trying to predict sexual offense. We are much better in predicting violence offense or just general recidivism. But we are not very good at predicting sexual offenses. It is just moderate positive level we can achieve. But we are quite good in predicting who does not reoffend. This part works better. In these risk assessment methods, we always have to think about the question whether the cup is half empty or half full. Should we have these assessments or should we not? Because the influences of these assessments, if we are wrong, for example, could be disastrous. This is from the meta-analysis of Faisal. And here we see actually that we are quite good at predicting. We can find these people that do not reoffend. In violent offense, in sexual offense, in overall general criminal offending. But in positive predictive values, the numbers are surprisingly low, especially in sexual offending. Well, let's skip psychopathy. Psychopathy is important, but do not have time for it. This is from SVR20, that is a structural professional judgment tool, and I'm using it sometimes when I try to assess the risk of reoffending of a sexual offender. And these are the items we are assessing. And it helps us. It helps us at least when we are planning the treatment and the aftercare. Which type of treatment does this offender need, and which type of aftercare can we provide him? And as I said, there are several and several methods nowadays. If we take into account of all the risk assessment methods, assessing the risk for violence and sexual offending and other criminal offending, I think there are more than 300 assessment methods at the present time. But none of them offers us the 100% prediction. We can also assess the motivational factors are really very important. It's difficult to treat people that are not motivated to work, to have a change. Some words about treatment with drugs, the so-called chemical castration. Castration is not considered to be a very good term in that sense. Maybe we should talk about testosterone antagonist pharmacology, pharmacological therapy. But we mean agents that lower the level of testosterone in blood, and they really work. There is a lot of experience from all over the world, also from Europe. But although we have the European Union, we do not have at the present moment any standards for prison psychiatry, for example, which type of care we should provide for prisoners in different psychiatric conditions, and which type of care we should offer for sexual offenders. It is very different in different European countries what we are doing right now and how we do treat the sexual offenders. We went to Denmark, for example, that have a long treatment periods, and they take rape, they take sexual offense very seriously. They have been using chemical castration for decades, and they have mandatory ambulatory treatment that is also an option. You can get a shorter sentence. You can get out of the prison if you take the medication. Then there are other countries, like Estonia, for example, or Finland, for example, when it does not affect your sentence. I think it is also in Norway that way. And in Finland, although we do have at the present moment the possibility to apply for this treatment, hormone treatment, nobody wants it. At the present moment, I know there has been one prisoner who has applied for this treatment. Well, we have different types of drugs. We have this old cyproterone, androcur, that has been used from 1960s already. There are modern injectable hormonal drugs that work very well. We do inject them, and we know that the patient has got it, and there are a bit less side effects. But again, anti-hormonal treatment has lots and lots of side effects. And this is not all we have here. There was an interesting study about 10 years ago. I think it has not been repeated, but it is really scary that lowering the testosterone level in blood for a long time seems to cause beta amyloid in the brain, just the way it happens in Alzheimer's disease. So these are very serious treatments we are talking about that have real serious side effects. There have been some algorithms, and there have been also treatment algorithms to use these medications, several levels, depending on how strong paraphilic symptoms one has. We can just proceed to the second and third level if we need more and more treatment. Sometimes it seems that SSRI, serotonin selective reuptake inhibitor, helps us a lot. These are quite easy medications to use. If it is not enough, we can combine it. But again, some critical notes. In Cochrane Review, they say that at the present moment, the studies we do have about medication do not allow us to make conclusions about pharmacological interventions. We have to have more studies. I showed you the cup already. The cup is from Basel, Switzerland. And in Switzerland, they are at the present time having very interesting fMRI brain scan studies with pedophiles. They are showing them three-dimensional films. You are just walking on the beach, and there are some half-naked women and some children and so on there. And then you have this brain scan going on all the time. And this is really very sophisticated, very interesting study they are making there. It's very difficult to fake what is going on in your brain. The old way was plethysmography. Do you know what it is? Yeah. But fMRI, much more modern. Okay, no time for that. Maybe I'll try to end in a couple of minutes and talk just a little bit about my patient, who is not a pedophile, but he's a peeping Tom. He's a voyeurist. He's more than 60 years old, but he's still sexually active. His testosterone levels are good. I have measured them. And he has had several prison sentences, but still he says, I have this disease. I have this pressure in me. He is a religious man, and he knows that he does something that is strictly forbidden. He should not do that. But I cannot help myself. It comes to me a couple of times in a year, and he knows he can resist the pressure for about a month. He turns to God, prays, and he lives in a halfway home at the present moment. He has a lot of help also. He has all kinds of activities, but the pressure rises, and he knows that about after a month, he cannot stand it anymore. And then he goes in the evening and looks into the windows. Sometimes he also does open the doors. He's a locksmith. He knows how to open the door. He has not raped anybody. But sometimes he has come to stand beside the bed during the night. And it is really scary, waking up in the morning and seeing that, oh, here is a strange man standing beside my bed. He's worried about this pressure he has. And he asked for help. We tried Asasaraya. It helped, but not enough. He said, well, doctor, something bad has happened to me. I went again. He does not want to go to prison anymore. And it seems that he will not get a sentence for what he has done now, just some minor things. And we started Andrakur, just for a short period of time. And it helped him. Put down the testosterone level, he stopped his voyeuristic behavior and continues on with Asasaraya. So, there is a lot of work to do, and we can do it much better. And I think the main message today could be that if we think of the Estonian system, then putting up a competence center, a competence center for sexual problems could help a lot. We should actively also offer a possibility for people with serious sexual problems, with paraphilias, with pedophilic tendencies, fantasies, to come and seek for help. Offer them psychotherapy, offer them medication, offer them assessment. There are interesting projects going on in Europe, and there has been an interesting project in Berlin, the Dunkelfeld project. Maybe we're going to hear about it today a little bit more. And I also found out that there is the first European pedophilia center opened in France, Lyon. I think I'll stop here. Thank you.